Thank you very much for being here today. If I'm not mistaken, I think this is indeed my fourth time speaking here at John Malden's conference. And I have to say, each year, the conference not only gets bigger and wider, but it gets also better and better. As a result, I'm very, very honored to be here in front of you today. And I want to thank again John and Johnson for inviting me here today. Now, I think 5 years ago, when I came here for the first time, I presented on China. Then 4 years ago, I came back again and I talked about China again. And 2 years ago, I talked about China. Now, I think you don't have to be a managed futures manager to guess what I'm going to be talking about today. I think you can probably guess the trend. So, I am going to talk about China. And there's several reasons, actually, I'm coming back to discuss this important topic. The first is that whenever I talk about China with Western investors, I find that the passions that China unleash are quite extreme. I've come to call it my theory of the two Jims. On the one hand, you have Jim Rogers, who I think John was trying to channel yesterday with his bow tie. On the one hand, you have Jim Rogers, who will tell you that, in essence, if you're not teaching Mandarin to your kids, well, you might as well be teaching them Egyptian hieroglyphs. They'll never be able to survive in the world of tomorrow. And on the other, you have Jim Chanos, who tells you that China is on a treadmill to hell and that everything where I live is about to implode. Meanwhile, of course, over the past 5 years, China has become one of the key stories in our financial markets. I think that if we look back objectively at the cycle that we just went through, we can all accept that this has been a very unique cycle, if only for one dominant feature. This is the first global economic recovery after a major recession that we have witnessed since the Second World War, where the global economy has been pulled higher not by the US, but by China. This is, of course, never happened before. The US has always been the leader out of every cycle. And just staying along with that theme, for the first time ever, we're seeing not only the Chinese central banks, but emerging market central banks everywhere tighten monetary policy before the Fed. This is something that's never happened before. And I think one of the previous speakers, the gentleman from GLG, was mentioning earlier how you are starting to see big changes as a result on the Asian currencies. And indeed, if you look at the renminbi today, the renminbi, which the Chinese government has promised to revalue by 3 to 5% a year, is now accelerating really rapidly. If you annualize the past 2 months' worth of appreciation on the renminbi, you'll find that you're more at a pace of about 8%. If you annualize the past month, you're more at a pace of about 12% per annum. So things are moving, things are changing in China, and it is this change, as Mark Faber was highlighting earlier, that is reshaping our world. Now, in the presentation that I'll go through, you'll see that I'm pretty much all focused on pictures, for an obvious reason. Pictures, as everyone knows, are worth 1,000 words. However, I would say that in China, given the inflation rate that we're having to deal with, it's probably more like 1,500 words. And this one, I think this picture, if I can leave you with one picture today, I'd like it to be this one. As you look at this incredible growth that China and emerging markets have been experiencing for the past decades, two decades, three decades, as far as China's concerned, we're talking about more than 10% annualized for 30 years in a row. We can't help but question, where does that growth come from? Now, I think one way to look at growth is to say that growth, at the end of the day, is always the result of demographics. You put more people into your system. Productivity of labor. You make sure that the labor that you have in your economy gets to produce more. Or productivity of capital.